This is Duke University.
All black, everything, everything black, culture over everything, y'all, we taking it back, black.
Welcome to Left of Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal. We're joined today by longtime journalist, music historian, Dr. Rickey Vincent, who's probably most well known for his earlier book on funk music, but he has a new book just published by Lawrence Hill Books, Party Music, the Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band and How Black Power Transformed Soul Music. How are you doing today, Rickey?
I'm doing great, Mark. Good to see you again.
How's life out there in the Bay Area?
Well, it's nice and comfortable out in California. We're not going through blizzards or any of that type of thing. So, sweet.
So Party Music was in part based on your doctoral dissertation.
Right.
Talk a little bit about, and you talk about this early in the book, about the kind of challenges to get a project of this nature published.
Well, it's been a long road. First to get the story out, because those guys didn't want to talk about the music that they played, because they were all card-carrying, you know, inner circle, trusted rank-and-file Black Panther Party members. And when I asked them, you know, can we talk about your music? They're like, well, but wait a minute. You know, we stood up to the power structure and we put out a plan for the revolution and da da da. So, yeah, but you also played music. And they're like, yeah, so? And it took a minute to kind of work them into an understanding that what I was trying to do was not sort of exploit them or exaggerate their their significance to the party overall, but I had to sort of paint a picture that nowadays people understand culture and politics in a way that's much more intertwined, and we have the hip hop generation to thank for that. So just getting the story to come together was one hurdle. Then, you know, kind of putting it together was another, and then trying to convince certain people that a story of this nature, that is a political history, it's a history of the Black Panther Party,
right,
but also a history of soul music at its sort of most strident in terms of its visions for Black liberation. And so these things are all connected, but the music publishers weren't really interested. The folks that are doing political history were, not necessarily, that interested. And the Academy was like, well, this is a little bit funky for us. And, a lot of the left books were, maybe not necessarily understanding how far down this thing goes in terms of what people were doing at the time of the Black Power era to transform themselves and transform this country.
You got an ally from, not someone who would have been an obvious ally, but a copy of your manuscript got passed on to Mumia Abu-Jamal, who had a chance to read it, and he helped to create the kind of connection that you eventually had with Lawrence Hill Books. How important was it for him to be able to read the manuscript and really co-sign, some of what you bring together in the context of party music?
Well, it was fundamental. Part of the research I did, I came across his own memoir of life, his life in the Black Panther Party. It was We Want Freedom, My Life in the Black Panther Party. And it was a matter-of-fact retelling of his political awakening and his visit to California and getting arrested in California, having to explain that to his mom back in Philadelphia, and his whole adventure. And he told it in a way that was really vivid. If you ever dealt with Mumia's work, it's not simply theories and proclamations. It's how people live a life of resistance. And so his book was kind of central already to the way I wanted to tell my story. He was a young person who believed in, it was time for change and wanted to do something about it. And that's really what the party was comprised of, for the most part. Young people, Black people, for the most part, it really felt like the time for change was, was upon them, and they were willing to take the steps to seize the time. So all of that was sort of already there. I had gone through so many changes to try to get the book published. I had finally got fed up and went to my radio station, KPFA, during the fundraiser, and you probably know how fundraisers go at radio stations. They have a lot of product that they give away and that they use as premiums, as gifts.
Right.
And so I figure on fundraiser, I'll go in there and stumble over crates of progressive books and things like that. And but when I went in there, Noelle Hanrahan was on the mixing board. She was doing the board op that day. And Noelle Hanrahan produces prison radio and a lot of Mumia's live from death row work. And so I was on a mission, and I said, how do I get a copy of my work to Mumia? And she showed me how to do it. And you know, sent it to Mumia. He really enjoyed it. He liked it. And like you said, he endorsed it, and he sent it to his agent, Frances Golden. We had an interesting conversation one day. She said, I don't know you, but Mumia told me to sign you up, so I'm going to sign you up. It was kind of a backhanded compliment. And eventually, you know, she called me one day after she read it. She said, wow, this is really good. I really appreciate this. And Frances goes way, way back. And she was friends with Paul Robeson back in the day. So I felt like it was in good hands because there is a chapter on the history of sort of musical resistance movements, and Paul Robeson plays a part in that discussion. So I was glad to sort of have her seal of approval when I started to tell that whole story arc.
You're watching Left to Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal. We're joined by Dr. Rickey Vincent talking about his new book, Party Music, The Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band, and how black power transformed soul music. You mentioned early in the book that, you know, the centerpiece of this book really is the band, The Lumpin'. Mm-hmm. And first hearing about The Lumpin' from another one of your Bay Area comrades, Boots Riley, who incidentally also wrote the foreword to Party Music, and that being kind of your introduction to the band. You know, there's been a lot of stuff that's been written about the Black Panther Party. I mean, I think there's a generation of young folks who think they actually know the full extent of the Black Panther story. You know, when you found out about the Lumpin', you know, were there things that surprised you about the band and particularly their role within the context of the Black Panther Party?
Their entire existence was a complete surprise to me. I grew up in the East Bay. My mother knew a lot of the Panther leadership in the late 60s. And so I remembered seeing Eldridge and Huey around the house as a child. But I was 5 years old, didn't make all those connections. And at the time, you know, they were serious. My mother was in some of the Marxist study groups that they had. And so at that time, the party members weren't in the house to party. They were in there to deal with some of their ideas, deal with, you know, some of their writing, some of their theories, some of their strategies and tactics and that type of thing. And so my personal experience was not hanging out with these guys, talking fashion, talking music, or anything like that. You know, so I sort of bought into that mythos that the Black revolutionary is some kind of detached, steely-eyed, stoic icon and on the fringe of the community, both literally and physically and socially, just, you know, they're sort of outsiders to the community where, you know, in fact, particularly in the East Bay, they were a part of the community. They were immersed in, they were the community. Black Panthers, that's Oakland. That's a big part of what the East Bay and what Oakland's all about. But their mythos just sort of maintained itself for a long time. And you know, the sort of outsiders to the narrative of the Panthers want to sort of reinforce this stereotypical image that they're just sort of not within the social fabric of the community. They're a little bit too far out. They're too militant. They're too violent. There's pathological tendencies. The community didn't really love them, and they didn't really love the people. They loved their guns or whatever you want to say. There's a lot of baggage that goes with the fact that the Panthers' legacy is as rich and varied and valued now as it ever was. So it was a revelation when Boots Riley told me this in 2002. And to him, it was just a rumor. He said, man, Rick, I heard, and he had been telling me little snippets of sort of Black power history over the years. And I would look into some of them, and he sort of knew, since I was in the academy, that I might pursue some of these ideas. Right. And so he threw that at me. I was like, man, that's, you're nuts. That's a crazy one. And but then it didn't take long to talk to some other former Panthers and other organizers, and they knew about the lumpen. And then I wound up talking to musicians like Lenny Williams, the singer, and other folks in the Bay Area musical community who knew about the lumpen. They knew about the band. They had seen their performances and this and that. And I was like, okay, they're a real group. Let me put my radio journalist hat on and go track down this band. And so it took a little bit of, you know, of both, of digging, you know, through, you know, library archives and you know, and the Black Panther paper and artifacts like that, and digging and talking to musicians. And Mark, you probably know how tricky it is to talk to musicians and try to get to something that, you know, is rock solid, because they all have their own interpretations, and usually they have egos, and they want to frame their story their way. And it was pretty amazing to finally get to these guys, and each one separately, didn't know I had talked to the others, was like, you know, wait a minute. First of all, get it straight. We're revolutionaries. We weren't musicians. And so I had to get that straight with them and set them up. And then they all told, you know, very, very consistent stories about, you know, they joined the party. They were willing to sacrifice their lives for, you know, for the change in their community. And then the party evolved, and it went through dramatic changes, particularly in 1970 and 71, when Huey Newton was released from jail in the summer of 1970. And he made these proclamations that had to do with affirming their work with the survival program, Survival Pending Revolution, and really re-engaging with the community in a way that he felt, you know, was on the community's terms. And yes, we know about the Breakfast for Children's programs and the sickle cell anemia testing and things like that that were for the community. But obviously a band is on the community's terms if it's a grooving, soulful funk band. And that's what they were. That's what the lumpen did. They took hits straight off the radio and cranked them. They recruited a band, and you could hear from a distance them singing Sly and the Family Stone music, them doing James Brown songs, them doing Curtis Mayfield's music. Then when you get up and listen to it, you realize they changed the lyrics to represent the party line. Party.
And, I mean, Rickey, for a moment, you know, for our audience, you know, talk about the broader landscape of what's happening culturally at this particular moment. You know, Hakeem Aboudi, Donnell Lee at the time, you know, often talked about the fact that as a poet, at some point he had to kind of change his mechanism and really begin to write poetry for the dance floor, particularly if he wanted to catch young folks, right? You know, it had to be something that they would hear that was natural to them musically, you know, that, and in this regard, I mean, you've written about this as brilliantly as anybody, you know, funk music was a natural choice in that regard. I mean, even more so than soul music, if you think about it. You know, soul music in some ways was kind of an older generational form where young folks tend to gravitate, particularly by the early 1970s, to funk music. But talk about some of the challenges that musicians faced. Again, this is an era where so many mainstream Black artists really had to take seriously what was happening politically. And some of them, I mean, radically changed up their game. I mean, Marvin Gaye is the best example of that. You know, Sly and the Family Stone, as you write about in the book, while they may not have been overtly political, they clearly were impacted by what was happening in the Bay Area, where they were born also. And even amongst you know, the political organizations, I mean, we talk about the lumpen, but here you have Elaine Brown also, you know, who's recording stuff from Motown, no less, you know, trying to bring kind of a revolutionary fervor to the music. So talk about what's happening more broadly culturally at this particular historical moment.
Yeah, well, this is the time when we think about that classic soul music that Stevie Wonder produced, that people were doing, that was some of their most visionary. Yeah. The early 70s, you talk about the OJs, things like Backstabbers and Ship Ahoy and stuff like that. We're talking about music with a really broad vision for the community, community's values, the community's roots, the community's future. And that built upon what was happening at the end of the 60s when artists were confronted, like you said, with revolution in the air. And they would go to shows, and people would not just be wearing the hip clothes and the berets and maybe having some of the look of some of the Black Panthers and other Black radicals, but they were shouting the chants. They were basically telling the artist, you better give me something with some fire, with you know, that can really bring it. And when you get down to that, you're talking about a groove as well. And then when you get down to the groove and the message, you're talking about James Brown, the godfather of soul.
Right.
And he was the one that stepped up, quite literally, because that's what his audience was telling him to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, they gave him the funk, if you think about it. And any great artist, if you say, see old James Brown shows, he'll start just vamping and grooving and bantering with the audience, kind of testing out what they want, what they like, what little groove they, you know, they enjoy. And then he'll hold on to that and work with that. And so James Brown was embedded in the community. And so when the community started to sort of soak up Black power, soak up Black revolution, you know, get into the Afro, get into being Afro-Americans, get into being Black, and discard the idea of being a Negro, the idea of trying to integrate as a goal, James Brown was in touch with the pulse of that. And you can see it reflected in the music that he produced. And so James Brown and other artists that fed on the work of James Brown and fed on, you know, the energy and the community at the time, they were compelled to tell it like it is, to bring some truth. Yes, they were singing soul, but everything had a little more edge to it. You can hear it in the difference between Otis Redding's version of Respect and Aretha Franklin's version of Respect. Because yes, it was a woman's, you know, she's different approach to the whole concept, but that music was hitting her band. Yeah. You know, they were like, we got to, boom, they have to hit it. Because that's where the people were. They wanted to be hit hard with some of that funk.
I mean, the strain that goes through both this book and your earlier book, right? This idea, the significance of the one. Right, that hard accented first beat, you know, is almost like a call to revolutionary action.
It is, and you know, people, it's sort of skirted, you know, past people's understanding. I mean, that's where the funk of the 70s, you know, resides, that you said, and that's what hip hop picked up on with all the samples, and even before the samples, the great DJs would take these hooks, take these riffs straight out of these funk songs. And lay them in the tracks for the rappers. And so everything hip-hop built on in terms of that syncopated funk beat that is fundamental to hip-hop, you have to give credit to the Black Revolution and to James Brown and his rhythm revolution for making all of that possible. And so it was really interesting that when we talk about the history of Black power, yes, there are important people, Malcolm X, Stokely Carmichael, France were known, you know, ideas, there were the Panthers themselves, there were all these things, but there was some glue that held everyone together, and the experience that everyone shared was Black music at that time. Everyone heard Aretha. Everyone danced to James Brown. Everyone. And that is part of the lived life of the people, and that's what history should be about. It should be telling you what people really went through, not just what laws were passed or who got arrested, but what was the lived life of the people at that time.
We're talking with Rickey Vincent, Dr. Rickey Vincent, longtime lecturer at University of California, Berkeley, author of the classic text on funk music and the new book, Party Music, The Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band and How Black Power Transformed Soul Music. Later in the book, Rickey, you have a quote from the last Abby Adoon of the Last Poets. And he talks about this real challenge that I'm sure, you know, many of the figures within Lumpen have dealt with, of trying to make this distinction between making radical art versus actually being engaged in radical politics. You know, that moment where an artist feels as though just making a radical song might not be enough, and maybe you give up the music, you know, to do more grassroots organizing in politics.
Well, it was even more stark back then for Abby Adoon, because you know, it was simply understood, and this may have gone back to the Jim Crow days, to Paul Robeson experience of just being completely excised, you know, from the establishment because of your political views as an artist, and what the stakes are involved. And but doing, you know, the work that the Last Poets was doing was so groundbreaking. It was so transversing boundaries. It was very important at that time for people to do that, for music to do that. And then the artists found themselves in this other place where they basically screamed out that it's time for action, that it's time for change. And then somebody would put a mirror in their face and they'd say, okay, what action are you going to do? Right. You know, how are you going to remain credible to your audience if you don't, you know, reflect and participate or in the art that you produce? You know, you have to represent it in some way. Abby Lincoln said that famous phrase, you become what you sing. Right. And if you're going to be credible, you need to at some level reflect that, you know, that work that you produce. Now, the thing was, the Panther Band, these guys are Panthers. They never got paid a penny. Right. Didn't have, you know, any, they didn't have those issues. They knew, they all had a background in rhythm and blues before they joined the party. They all had a background in the hustle and the bustle of, you know, bringing your equipment to a nightclub and going through all those changes and, you know, the backstage and getting prepared and doing an act. And they knew that part. But all the other ancillary issues, they didn't have to worry about that, and they didn't worry about it because they had other duties. You know, after the show, they packed up their equipment and did security that night at the offices. I mean, they didn't get that kind of fanfare. They got a little. It's in the book. They got some, but for the most part, that wasn't their concern. But the larger question of, you know, particularly black music, if you're going to, you know, get people to move, and it's kind of a figurative statement and a literal statement. If you're going to get them to move, if you're a great dance music artist, your goal is to get people on the floor, is to get them to move. That's one of the most important kind of fundamental aspects. If you're a black musician, you got to make a move. You got to get them. You got to get people going. But then there's this other dimension of, if you are going to sing about social justice, if that's going to be your message, then at some level you have to move the people towards social justice. And artists, and you have a lot of artists that came into the entertainment industry in the 1960s just looking to get paid, just looking to get known, just, you know, getting some notoriety, you know, get yourself on the radio.
Trying to make a living, right?
Just trying to make a living. And then, you know, what happened? There was this storm, there was this revolution in the air. It was revolutionary change that was taking place everywhere. And some people really believed, and Abi Odun wrote about that. You know, he felt that, you know, this, we were going to have a revolution. This place is going to burn to the ground, and we'll start over with something new. That's what he believed at that time. And there were some people that really did. And so, you know, what role do you play with your craft, you know, to help push people towards social change or whatever level, you know, you're going to be doing? And everyone was taking the task at that point, that late 60s. Everyone, whether you're talking about Lou Rawls or Billy Paul or Natalie Cole or anyone that might be, you know, performing at that time, you know, somebody's going to ask you, well, what are you doing for the revolution? You know, what are you doing for the people? You know, what is your work? Jimi Hendrix had to go through a lot of that. Yeah. You know, are you a real brother? Well, are you down for what word for our revolution, that type of thing. So everyone had to deal with that. Everyone had to cope with that at some level. And then you find in the result, there was an incredible amount of work that actually did respond to the revolution. That's why the music, the soul music, the funk and the soul at that time was so compelling. It was because the movement and the people made it so.
Which raises a really interesting and I think important point that you make here, Rickey. You know, this was a unique historical cultural moment in terms of the larger political activity that's going on, right? It's one of those moments, right, where, you know, folks can grasp and really see real change. Are we unfair in some ways to this generation of artists whether they be R&B or jazz or hip hop, you know, for them not making that kind of music in the absence of the same kind of historical political movement?
That's the push and pull, and I'm sure you have that with your classes, and you have to bite your tongue sometimes. You want to crack on some artists that just did some sort of knucklehead production or got themselves into something stupid, and you want to just zero in on them when it's really bigger than them. Yeah. And you're right. There's a lot of folks that at the time that the book focuses on, which is the end of the 1960s, these people were swept into, you know, a hurricane, really. And so their art, I mean, who knows if Edwin Starr would have done a song, you know, War, What Is It Good For, if it wasn't for the Vietnam War and things of that nature. He was doing fine with 25 miles and running. He had his own little soul legacy. He could have kept on that, but no, the movement pushed him and everyone, even at Motown Records, you know, to go for it, you know, to go for what you know, go for what you believe in, you know, and still try to get paid.
Right. I mean, again, Marvin's a classic example. I mean, this is a cat who wanted to be the Black Frank Sinatra, you know, throughout the 1960s, and the political moment demanded that he rethink, you know, what his art was going to be at that point.
And the thing was, he started from within. He said, you know, where is my heart at this? You know, I'm still mourning Tammy Terrell. I'm hearing these stories from my brother of life in Vietnam and looking at the world and what's going on? And then he used all his skill and his talent of telling a story through soul music, arranging music the way he understood it and how to do it, and created not just a masterpiece, but like you said, this moment, this watershed moment. This is, music is completely different from here on out. It can tell the truth and yet still show all the sophistication and wisdom of somebody that has made it through the Black experience. And so, you know, Marvin's transformation is emblematic of what people went through at that time. And yes, they wanted to do art and they wanted to be sufficient. Yes, they wanted to get paid, but the revolution swept them away. And it happened to everyone, not even people that were artists. Everybody was feeling this. Everybody had, you know, certain fabrics and fashion and paintings on their walls and certain designs in their houses and, you know, the iconography of the revolution, the red, black, and green, and the fist and the afro, all these different things. People were not just putting these in their home. They were engaging with them. They were reaching for them. They were lunging for all these artifacts of a new identity, a new Black man, right, and woman, because this was the moment when the Negro was being put aside.
Death. Yeah.
And, you know, if you think about it, I wrote it sort of just kind of casually in the introduction, you know, this is the time when the transformation from Negro to Black took hold. And it wasn't before that. 1960, you're a Negro. 1970, you're Black. What the heck happened?
Yeah.
How did that transformation take place? Was it the Civil Rights Act of 1965? I don't think so. I think it had something more to, was it Malcolm X? Well, Malcolm X talked about that. You know, it was Stokely Carmichael on the Freedom from Fear March in 1966. Well, okay, but, you know, what made it happen? You'd have to start with James Brown's number one song, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud.
Yeah.
And he was tying together, the energy was in the air everywhere. And people weren't quite necessarily all united about what that energy meant. And James Brown put that together. He said, this is what it means. Right here, right now, on the one, with your bad self. Say it loud, a Black and I'm Proud. You got to get with that. And, you know, it changed Black music completely. Because up until then, the tradition of metaphors and innuendos and poems, you know, through the blues was sort of fundamental to Black music. Right. Blues and gospel, the ideals of, you know, sort of a freedom over the horizon. And James Brown said, you can be explicit with what you need to say right here, right now. You got this funk, you got this beat, got this rhythm, got this rhyme, and boom, here it is. Right. And so in a lot of ways, that experience was a cornerstone of this transformation from Negro to Black. And there really hasn't been something that significant to take place to the entire community since.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
you know, we can talk about semantics and the African-American and how that terminology was developed in the 1980s, but that was not as connected to the whole identity transformation that took place at the end of the 60s. And like I said, there was so many factors making that connection, putting the Negro to bed and creating this new Black person. And the culture is central to understanding that. And the culture of the revolutionary culture of the Black radical movement is central to understanding that. That's why it's still so compelling to people today. They're still trying to figure out
how do we put that in a bottle?
How do you capture that and sell it again? And I mean, it's a real tough one, and but you got to start with it. At least you got to kind of everybody get up to speed. What really happened?
Yeah.
Okay, and I don't know how much you follow some of these historical documentaries, but there was one called Soundtrack to a Revolution that came out, and it was a brilliant sort of reconstruction of the civil rights era, and it talked about the music that was played during the civil rights era. And I really enjoyed it, and they had a lot of the freedom songs, and then they wove in stories of, you know, the marches and the freedom rides and the sit-ins and things like that. Oh, it was brilliant. And it ended around 1965. Like, dude, give me your part two. And let's do the soundtrack to the Black Power Revolution that was sort of the second part. And I think if people read the book and they understand that, you know, I connect the foundation of the civil rights movement as it's understood, you know, through the work of Rosa Parks and Dr. King and SNCC and all the folks that were doing the courageous work, you know, at the dawn of the first half of the 1960s. But then the second half, I'm sure most of the histories that you've read, Mark, they sort of take a different tack. They say it was discordant. They say it was unsuccessful. They say it was too violent.
They gloss over it. I mean, they really gloss over the cultural significance of it. Yeah.
When it was like, it was the knockout blow, if you will, to second-class citizenship.
Yeah.
You know, the civil rights movement, you know, they threw a lot of the punches, and it was Black power that was the knockout blow to inequality, if you think about it. And one way you can understand that is to understand the identity transformation that took place. And you can literally measure that if you study the music.
We've been joined today by Dr. Rickey Vincent, author of the new book, Party Music: The Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band and How Black Power Transformed Soul Music. Longtime lecturer at UC Berkeley, also a longtime historian, author of the classic book on funk music. Thanks for joining us today, Rickey.
It's my pleasure, Mark.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, the Black Panther Party very proudly presents The Lumpin'!